Hi, Michelle.
Hello.
Thanks so much for accepting our invitation to the annual conference at COES 2016 on inequalities. Thanks also for accepting our invitation to this conversation, which is part of the work that we do around the theoretical agenda of the center. We were thinking a lot about your presentation yesterday on Getting Respect, the book. And some of the issues that you raised were very, very interesting in terms of how people respond to stigmatization and how people are dealing in their everyday lives discrimination or stigma. And we were very curious about how you develop this this idea, this more responsive way in which people react to this ways of discrimination. And one of the questions that we would like to ask you in terms of, in a retrospective way, is how you get to this idea of having an agent that is an individual, a subject that is able to respond mm-hmm. or able to resist or negotiate stigma, mm-hmm. you know, and how your position in terms of sociology, a sociology that is able to provide those tools to understanding also these ways in which people react to these mm-hmm. forms of discrimination.
Mm-hmm. So what we did for the book is we asked over 400 people in the New York suburbs, Rio de Janeiro and Tel Aviv, middle class and working class, male and female, to describe to us a specific incidents where they feel that they were treated unfairly and how they responded. So, and we also asked them more general questions such as, what do you teach your kids about how to respond to racism, or what are the best tools that your group has at its disposal to respond? So we took all these responses and we developed a typology in a very inductive fashion. So when we were starting the project, we had in mind Albert Hirschman's Exit, Voice, and Loyalty. Do you fight, you know, or the flight or fight, you know, mm-hmm. attitude. And we really wanted to analyze in a very fine, you know, detailed way the whole range of responses. Mm-hmm. So I think what we did is really this typology emerged from reading the transcripts. Mm-hmm. So I remember, for instance, for Brazil, there's a kind of response that we labeled acting against stereotype, mm-hmm. which is to say, oh, me, I never have any problem with white people. I'm not the kind of person who ever gets stigmatized because I behave in such a way that I don't give them a chance to stigmatize me. Mm-hmm. So that's a little bit like the woman who say, oh, I'm never mm-hmm. victim of sexism because I'm such a strong and smart woman. Mm-hmm. So it's a way of saying, you know, I'm above my category. Mm-hmm. And that's a response that we just didn't find at all in the U.S., which in itself is a very interesting finding. Mm-hmm. In the U.S., African-Americans simply cannot say that they are the kind of African-Americans who are so superior that they are never. So that, you know, in that sense, it was a radically, I think, inductive approach. And it is true that some of the responses might be viewed as very agentic. So we find that in the U.S., confrontation is much more likely. But we don't want to say that the only kind of response that is agentic is confrontation, because we discuss a lot this other kind of response, which we describe as management of the self, which is really the kind of work that, you know, psychological work, basically, that people engage in to weigh the various options they have and to consider what are the cost of, for instance, confronting versus not saying anything and being very angry and frustrated. So as they were describing to us their responses, they were also spelling out to us the different things that they were weighing. So for instance, one of the examples that I gave yesterday is that of this guy who's in an elevator where someone makes a joke about blacks and monkeys, and he's very upset and he's in a corner and he says, I don't want to get angry because I'm gonna get fired and I need this job and I've been in the job for only 1 week. So I don't think as researchers it's our job to say this guy lacks agency. Mm. It's more to understand what are the constraints that exist that make it more likely that some responses, rather than others, will be used by, you know, people in the U.S. versus Israel, or by working class people versus middle class people. The more, one of the hypotheses at the beginning was, the more market capacity you have, the more highly skilled you are, the more likely you are to confront, because you have much more capacity to find other jobs, you know, greater value on the job market. But that did not turn out to be that true. There is a slightly greater likelihood of confronting among the middle class, but really not much. And then the question, of course, is why? So there we turn toward the culture of professionals, which is one of conflict avoidance to a much greater extent than it is among workers. But also the workers have access to unions, have access to a lot of legal tools that professionals don't have, that they mobilize when it comes to confronting. Legal tools are often mobilized. We talk about getting the HR department in to demonstrate that, you know, supervisor is not dealing with workers equally. So I think all this to say, when it comes to agency, or, you know, to see the Arab Palestinians who don't confront as much, so we don't want to say that they don't confront because they're alienated. They don't confront because they don't think that they, that the polity, the Israeli polity, will include them ever. So it's a very, you know, nuanced, I think, understanding when it comes to taking into consideration how much leeway people have.
And in those terms, when you gave your presentation yesterday, you were giving a much more comprehensive angle in terms of understanding the ways in which people respond, right, to discrimination. And you were saying that we should take in account not only political context, but also historical contexts, institutional elements, and obviously cultural repertoires, and and groupness. And in the field work, in when you were doing the interviews and when you were analyzing your interviews, your data, how did you include all those elements in terms of the analysis? Because, for example, institutional elements such as those that you are mentioning, how do we include those in the way in which we are dealing with the interviews and what people are telling you in the interviews? How do we engage with those?
Well, when the project started, we really didn't know that our explanation was going to include groupness. That came really quite late in the project, as we were comparing the five groups, which includes African Americans, Black Brazilians, and three groups in Israel, which are Ethiopian Jews, who are Black but Jewish, and immigrants from Africa, Mizrahim, who are Oriental Jews, who are stigmatized at the bottom of the labor market but understand themselves as being highly assimilated and on their way up, for whom, you know, the fact that they are Mizrahim is often underplayed, even if they will describe interactions with their father-in-law, who's not happy that their daughter is marrying a Mizrahim, if they are European Jews, for instance, because Mizrahim are viewed as inferior culturally, less sophisticated, etc. And the third group are the Arab Palestinians, which is the group, the first group that we selected, which is the most clearly excluded group in Israel, who are of another nation and are presumed often to be the enemy within, because they're presumed to be sympathetic to the Palestinian cause. And as we were looking at these five groups together, we came to focus on how hesitant each group was when they were experiencing an event, and how much the certainty that they were experiencing unfair treatment was tied to how salient is their identity as group members. So Arab Palestinians, African Americans, when you interview them and you ask the basic questions, you know, can you describe yourself to me, their identity as group member is immediately salient. Not so for Black Brazilians, for whom national identity is more salient than racial identity. So as we were, it was very complicated, you know, because first we produced all these tables and we could see what kind of responses were salient where. And then methodologically, the approach was to try to reconstruct a posteriori, these are the patterns we found, how can we make sense of them? So the case of the place of institutions became very salient when it came to Arab Palestinians, because they cannot serve in the army, which means that even if they are citizens of Israel, the fact that the army, the Israeli army, is such a powerful mechanism of integration and also of mobility, because people find jobs through the friends that they made in the army. And also Arab Palestinians have a separate set of school system, which is inferior, and which many Palestinians want because it's one of the keys through which they maintain their culture. But nevertheless, it contributes to their social immobility. So looking at these institutions helped us make sense of the fact that they did not mention ever feeling misunderstood, which is a category that is salient in the U.S., because we thought it's simply they know they are so disconnected, as exemplified by the fact that they cannot serve in the army, that they don't claim integration. They don't expect to be understood. So, and then, you know, institutions, I mean, in the case of African Americans, they are very integrated institutionally, and where they are interacting most with whites are in schools, in college, and at work. Their neighborhoods, and we have data on the extent to which their life is segregated, you know, their neighborhood life, their friendships are, well, especially the neighborhoods are very, very segregated. So, but when it comes to institutions such as school, when you interview them about where the incidents happen, most of them happen at work and at school. So it's a little bit like, the institutions were partly built into our interview schedule because we asked them where the incident occurred, but they also came in a posteriori in our explanation as we tried to make sense of what we found.
Well, it's very interesting how you describe these different contexts in which people can experience this discrimination, right? I mean, as you were saying, there are other contexts such as neighborhoods, which is different for them compared to, I don't know, work or school, and it also makes me think about what we were just talking about, the ways in which we understand from a theoretical point of view the space of agency, you know, because normally we would expect, well, there's a normative angle to understanding what agency means in sociological theory, right? Mm-hmm. It means that the individual can face the structural forces in particular ways, which are normally described by a variety of possibilities, right?
Yeah.
But in a way, you're suggesting that it's much more complex. It depends on, you know, contexts. It depends on the power of certain institutions, right? And it also makes me think about how we go back to theory and go back to making theory about agency, right? I mean,
yeah, that is a very good point. I think that the literature on agency often presumes that the kind of agency that is best is an active agency. Mm. It's facing the domination, and that this is what gives you resilience. There is, at the end of the interviews, we gave questionnaires that allowed us to measure different aspects of mental health having to do with self-efficacy, for instance. And we will not publish that because the results, you know, if most of their description of incidents have to do with confronting 10 years before, and they fill our questionnaire and it turns out that they are the people who confront are the people who are most depressed, I think the causal link is just too vague to be able to make an argument. But we did find that confrontation is correlated with a lesser sense of well-being and all that. So we were very puzzled thinking, well, does this mean that the gains of the civil rights movement that were collective gains that depended on collective mobilization maybe came at the, did they come at the cost of individual well-being, you know? Is it, under what conditions is it more costly for the individual to shut up and put up or to confront? So our data suggests that no response is the response that is best correlated, but it's also with well-being, but on the other hand, it's also the response that brings about least social change. So I think the literature on agency is so important because it helps us understand social change, right? Yeah. But what the data suggests is, I think, in fact, social change comes through all kinds of ways, that it's not necessarily confrontation.
Yeah, I'm thinking about how, in your own work, you know, how the pragmatic angle, the pragmatic theory came into your own work.
Yeah.
in order to understand the ways in which people tolerate, justify, you know, mm-hmm. inequality in their everyday mm-hmm. lives,
yeah.
you know, and how it has been such an important contribution to the field of studies of inequality and mm-hmm. the reproduction of inequality, to understand how really in everyday lives it's not so easy, you mm-hmm. know, or I don't know, easy for agents, for individuals mm-hmm. to respond confrontationally to inequality mm-hmm. and somehow people deal with inequality in pragmatic ways. You mm-hmm. know, they may have a very critical angle on some issues, but on the other hand, they may act differently in their mm-hmm. everyday lives, you know, mm-hmm. and because it involves a subjective cost,
mm-hmm.
you know. So
yeah.
it makes me think about that as well. I mean, mm-hmm. how to connect those things with the reproduction of inequality, yeah. on the other hand.
Yeah, and I think also, as you know from some of my previous books, like The Dignity of Working Man, which is a book comparing black and white workers in New York and white and North African workers in France, that even beyond the question of how they say, because we only deal with narratives, how they say they responded to a specific situation, independently of the situation, they nevertheless draw very strong boundaries toward the middle class or toward the poor, mm. which the book argues typically are very moral boundaries. So in some ways, those are also part of the responses to inequality, right? To say, fine, we're working class people. We are simply, they self-define as people who are just survivors, mm. people who are struggling, people who are trying to pay their bills and to keep their kids out of prison, even if they don't have a lot of resources. And the first chapter of the book is titled The World in Moral Order, because a lot of what they try to do is keep it together in a way that they remain respectable, but respectability is not a goal in itself. It's mm-hmm. simply that they try to keep their life together. And then they go to draw really strong boundaries, stronger in France than in the US, toward middle-class people who are called the Ken and Barbie people. Mm. And in France, they're depicted as people who are so ambitious that they lack any sense of solidarity with their friends. Mm. So they will, you know, not pay attention to their children or their partner or drop their friends if they lose their job. Mm. Their moral depiction of the middle class is very, very critical, which one could describe as very much part of the agency of how they deal with inequality. That might not be salient in the context of their description of a specific incident. But when you interview them about what they think about the upper middle class, they're just super critical. Mm. I mean, to call the upper middle class the Ken and Barbie people is really quite damning, you know, because it involves what, superficiality, lack of integrity, you know, narcissism, beautiful people who are kind of empty, like dolls, you know. I don't know exactly what this specific respondent had to. So in other words, I think when you think about how people deal with inequality, it's both when confronting specific incidents, but also mm-hmm. more generally these representation mm-hmm. of social class that they use to navigate.
Yeah.
Just as they have stereotypes of the poor that are very damning as well.
Yeah, I'm thinking, I mean, as we have been discussing in this conference as well, about the ways in which the agenda on the top one, or the study of the elites and polarization, mm-hmm. most of the arguments developed by Piketty in his book, Capital, I'm thinking about the ways in which there is a question in terms of how moral boundaries are going to be depicted towards that group, you know, mm-hmm. which seems to be also quite abstract because
yes.
it's global, international.
Yes. Yeah.
Every country has someone that appears on Forbes magazine,
yeah.
but it's not an actual agent or subject that one can
yeah.
connect to, you know, in
yeah.
everyday life.
Yeah.
But I wonder whether there's going to be a production of moral boundaries
mm-hmm.
In order to resist that mm-hmm. subject or that mm-hmm. position, basically.
Well, I'll mention two things. I mean, we're conducting this interview a week before the American election, mm-hmm. where some people could think of Donald Trump as the 1%, and mm-hmm. how is he read morally by the American population. Mm-hmm. Many people, often working class, lower middle class people, embrace him because he is successful. Mm-hmm. Financially, economically, and they admire this because they project in him their self-concept as people who can live the American dream, he is the American dream. Mm. And then there's many middle-class people or upper-middle-class people who really think of him as trash because he is so ruthless and he has no sense of noblesse oblige and he is so exclusive of immigrants and he has no generosity in him. So one could certainly think of, read the American situation now a week before the election totally through this lens of who is this person and how he's interpreted differently. I was reading recently the abstract of a new paper. I haven't read the paper yet, but by Rachel Sherman, who is at the New School, and she studied how the rich are raising their kids. And it is, she argues that the rich are raising their kids by teaching their kids to be very generous and noblesse oblige. So it's a way to redeem themselves from being this, I don't know if it was the 1% or the 0.01% that she studied, but it was really interesting that a lot of her results have to do with the moral teaching. And she interpreted it, if I recall, as a way for them to deculpabilize themselves, to say, we have everything, we don't struggle in life, everything is easy for us, and therefore we need children who are not bratty, who are not princesses, who would be like the opposite of, you know, Paris Hilton or, you know, this Hollywood elite of beautiful people who are just very narcissistic and self-serving. So that I thought was really interesting. It's like this 1% would be reversing the boundary on the basis of which they would be criticized most as people who have everything and don't give a damn about anyone.
Yeah. So it's very interesting, you know, how it works on, it may work on both ways.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, there is a structural, there are structural forces in which, you know, give us the view that most resources are accumulated on one side rather than the rest.
Yeah.
So, but there is a way in which it appears to be a way in which people can respond, you know, using these moral boundaries. But on the other hand, we know that it's difficult to reverse, you know, to reverse how structurally resources are allocated and distributed, you know.
So. Yeah, and I guess one of the criticisms that could be addressed to the focus on recognition that is at the center of this new book, Getting Respect, is that, or even the dignity of working man. So if the point is for working class people to simply feel better about themselves because they are drawing moral boundaries that allow them to feel that they are above people above, what is the meaning of that work if, in fact, they don't get more resources, you know? So how do we translate these symbolic boundaries into a transformation of the resources so that they have access to? So part of me agrees with this criticism because at the end of the day, if their life remains very miserable, what difference does it make that they are? On the other hand, you cannot entirely discount the sense of self because it influences how they orient themselves in life and their sense of social resilience. I think for people who are equally deprived of resources, social resilience comes from network, comes from hope. There are really important papers by a woman named, medical anthropologist named Catherine Panter Briggs, who studied Syrian refugees in camps and people in Afghanistan in camps. And she argued that those who are most resilient are those who were able to develop narratives of hope. So narratives do make a big difference, and they affect resilience. So it's not just a question of, you know, some have resources and others don't, and everyone should have resources. You know, this is a kind of very primal Marxism. The criticism would be sense of self makes a huge difference on how people who have equal amount of resources are able to deal with the challenges that come their way, and whether they're able or not to develop narratives about hope, which can allow them then to project themselves into the future and have long-term strategies about what they're going to do for themselves and their community and their families. So this is in some ways a response that draws on, you know, narratives, and often those narratives are discounted as superstructure, lies that people tell about themselves. So I think it's really important to reconsider what difference they make in people's lives.
Yeah, we've been doing research in COAS about about the ways in which people that have experienced upward mobility in Chile are also quite critical of the extent to which meritocratic principles work in their everyday lives, you know? So there is a gap or a sense of frustration in a way because people have somehow have followed what seemed to be adequate in order to have some recognition, some a relatively good position in social structure, but then realize that there are some boundaries that are much more rigid that that they expected them to be. So I wonder if these narratives can be helpful in these contexts as well, you know, in which there is an actual frustration with something that people expected to have for themselves, not only in terms of resources, but also in terms of social recognition of the efforts or merits of their own trajectories.
Yes, in Bourdieusian terms, it would be something like how you get there makes a very big difference in terms of what kind of habitus you develop. And this habitus remains a marker that those who have been there before will use to exclude you because you don't have this sense of privilege that came with having parents who were professionals, for instance. So the efforts that you had to deploy on your way up are then used by people who have always been up to to look at you as someone who was too much of a striver, right? There is this wonderful book by Jules Naudet, a French scholar, who studied the people who were very steeply upwardly mobile in the U.S., France, and India. And it's interesting because they're being mobile, but in systems that are radically different in terms of the degree to which there are openings. And his work is partly interesting because he looks at how they are looking back to the people they left behind, their family, their community, and how much they're able to stay connected with them, and what is the sense of loss that they also experience on their way up, you know, like, and that's where the question of recognition or feeling at home or feeling that you live a life that is authentic, a life that really feeds your sense of being fulfilled, you know, and often these people are quite, they are, what's the word? They feel a little bit like they're empty because the effort has been too big. And but this varies. I forget the detail of his analysis, but of course the caste system in India, being as it is, means that there are many more ceilings.
Absolutely.
And also maybe each caste has a culture that is far more distinct, which means that passing each step is much more difficult. And in the U.S., the middle class is far less, or the upper middle class, far less marked culturally. It's largely based on spending what you can buy. So your car is a marker of, if you have a Tesla, then you've, you know, Tesla as a marker that you really make a lot of money because those cars cost, you know, $80,000, $100,000. So it's much more possible to buy your way up, whereas in France, you cannot buy your way up to the same extent without being really the scorn. Is scorned as nouveau riche. So it's a very interesting analysis from the perspective of how the formation of the self is shaped by the kind of trajectory that people have and also what kind of system they operate in. I think Bourdieu does a lot of that too, but I think his approach to habitus is more like, you know, like he talks about this habitus clivé, remember that?
Yes.
Which is the people who have been upwardly mobile but have working class origins, right? Anyway, you know that literature better than I do. Yeah. So,
I mean, he also uses himself as a as a
object,
as a character to describe this middle class. I mean, this mismatch between habitus and
the conditions.
The conditions, and in order to talk a little bit about. I mean, he doesn't put it in those terms, but in a way, he's describing a self that is going through a painful trajectory in which it's difficult to feel that he or she belongs to a particular you know, context that may feel, you know, authentic in that sense.
Exactly.
And I'm thinking about, because you talk about resilience and you talk about narratives of hope and. And we've been talking, I mean, at this center about how to engage on debates of social cohesion, or at least talk not only about social conflict, the tensions, you know, of belonging in this case, but also how people engage on narratives that are relatively shared, common, not... It's difficult to think about a kind of a national narrative, but we're not thinking of on those terms. But in terms of these narratives that are, my impression is that are somehow unavailable for people that are on their way up or at least changing their positions in social structure. For example, through education or through migration or through, I don't know, those kinds of changes. But it's somehow complicated. It's difficult to address a narrative that gives them some recognition for that effort, for that change, even for the suffering involved in their selves, you know, and in terms of their identities and the tensions. For example, my work is on the tensions of authenticity. So people may feel authentic in relation to their parents, their previous neighborhood, but they also feel authentic for what they have been, what they have done, you know, with their education or their credentials or their current work. So it's so complex to deal with those senses of authenticity. But in a way, if there are some narratives that are more, I mean, relatively shared or more complex in terms of collective identities, it would feel at least that you can somehow expect a recognition of someone or another that is somehow meaningful, you know, because...
Yeah. As opposed to being viewed as a class traitor, for instance. I think in the context of the American dream, being upwardly mobile is so institutionalized and valued as a, you know, way of being that it's much easier for people who are very upwardly mobile, on the one hand, to be valued by their family of origin as someone who's made it, as opposed to as a class traitor or as a sellout, you know. That I think that repertoire is in much more available. And I think the question of authenticity that you've worked in is so interesting from the perspective of recognition, because it also means how do you sustain a sense within yourself that what you did is okay if you don't have other... cultural scripts that you have access to that feeds to you the notion that what you've done is worthy, right? I mean, it's very complicated, I think. I was going to say that the question of resilience that we've worked on, it's in the context of another project, a book titled Social Resilience in the Neoliberal Era, where in the U.S. now, with the neoliberal turn in general, there's been a lot on grit, right? Individual resilience, and it's been viewed as very much part of the neoliberal agenda to get individuals to be resilient as individuals and put themselves by the britches. And the gamble we took in this book, Social Resilience, which came out of the Successful Society Program, is to say, no, we want to think about social resilience. What are the cultural scripts that makes community resilient, or that makes, you know, and what are the institutions through which people gain a sense of value, that these institutions and cultural repertoires can act as scaffoldings or buffers against this daily assault that people are experiencing as they are confronting the effects of neoliberalism through, you know, greater job insecurity, etc. So in that respect, you can probably compare societies in terms of how readily they make these tools available. So I don't know, in a context like the Chilean society, where you have a middle class that grew quickly, right, and that is relatively prosperous, what are the scars of this mobility? You know, there are literatures that deal with these scars. I mean, I know at Harvard we had some graduate students who were working on the working class students at Harvard who had a great many mental health problems. They all spent tons of time at the mental health services, and that is very much a kind of cost that is not acknowledged by the institution. So,
I mean, I was also curious about how you were also starting to engage on issues of health, mental health, from the perspective of a cultural sociologist as well, you know, because it's something. I think it's a very interesting angle, and it's very interesting the way in which a sociologist can engage with these topics in a non how can I say, subordinated way, mm-hmm. you know, because most of sociologists that work on mm-hmm. health, it's part of a, are in a position in which sociology is mm-hmm. something that it's not at the core, or sociological mm-hmm. perspective is not at the core of the interest. Yeah. It's rather a more complementary
exactly.
angle, you know.
Yeah.
And I think that the way in which you're posing the questions mm-hmm. gives it a completely fresh mm-hmm. perspective. And I was curious about that.
Well, you know, we in the Successful Society program, we got to it through this literature on the health gradient, which shows that the more unequal our societies, the less good are the health outcome for the population mm-hmm. within that society, not only for the poor, but also for the more well off. So, and then from the project on getting respect, we got to this huge literature on the impact of racism on health. Mm-hmm. So the work of Nancy Krieger, for instance, you know, or mm-hmm. David Williams, and typically they use scales about perceived racism. The big difference between what they do and what we've done is that, one of the difference is that they kind of, you know, they use scales that are, but they are able to measure exactly how there's a large literature on how perceived racism translates into these negative health outcomes. Mm-hmm. David Williams' work in particular. Mm-hmm. So I don't think we have innovated there as much as, you know, try to broaden how people mm-hmm. think about what these experiences are. I would have liked, it's a huge literature, and there's a lot of people who are just, you know, adding one variable mm-hmm. after the other. People are now using biomarkers mm-hmm. like swabs mm-hmm. to determine the effect on cortisol. Mm-hmm. So I feel like it's a big industry, you know, mm-hmm. it's not one that I am part of. Mm-hmm. But I've been, to go back to your question about social cohesion, there is a large foundation in the U.S. called the Robert Johnson Foundation, Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, that launched. They had David Williams do a huge study of racial disparities in health a few years ago, and following that, they decided to launch a huge initiative that they called Cultures of Health. Mm-hmm. And one of the main slogans in that initiative, which is really an initiative that is conducted in connection with a lot of nonprofit, the YMCA. They mm-hmm. want to get Americans to become more healthy. Mm-hmm. And then the question is, how do they do this? By, you know, engaging all kinds of association, having more bike path, all kinds of things. But they also have a theory behind it. And one of the main slogans is, we are all in it together. So mm-hmm. the idea is to foster mm-hmm. social solidarity, social mm-hmm. cohesion. And this is very interesting because they were talking about culture and did not know a lot about culture. The mm-hmm. person who was in charge of this is a person, very interesting guy named Alonzo Plow, who was previously at Los Angeles in charge of earthquake preparation. Mm-hmm. And they would put billboards all over town saying, you know, get to know your neighbor because you will need them one day. So using, you know, cultural messaging to yes. create solidarity, to say you need social cohesion.
Yeah.
So, you know, that social cohesion was often thought in terms of network. But in the Successful Society Project, we were interested in how to foster solidarity. So they asked us to co-edit with them a special issue of this journal, Social Science and Medicine, which really a goal of agenda setting. Mm-hmm. And they asked one of my colleagues, Mabel Berezin, and I to co-edit this special issue with them. And the introduction of the special issue is around mutuality, mm-hmm. Mobilizing, and messaging. So what we did is to bring together cultural sociologists who had studied social movement, mobilizing, mm-hmm. who had studied the diffusion of messages, like Michael Schutzen, mm-hmm. who wrote a wonderful paper on the anti-smoking movement. And, you know, really to think about these three paths, you know, how do you message and how do you mobilize to create greater solidarity? So in some ways, as I discovered that this conference that you're organizing was about social coherence mm-hmm. or social cohesion, I was thinking, you know, a lot of that literature that I know of, the work of Lisa Berkman, for instance, social cohesion as sustained by social networks. That's what she does, you know. But there's a lot of different pathways. And there would be like more structural approaches to understanding what fosters it. And then there's the more cultural approach, which we try to consider in this special issue. So I don't know, have you all spent a lot of time looking at these different pathways?
We have been working a lot on the social network approach, I think. That's the one that we are trying to measure at this stage. And we've been looking at work that has been done in Germany, for example, in some other countries in Europe, in order to measure social cohesion as the networks that the individual has, and also networks in terms of neighborhoods and extended networks in terms of family and like granovater as well, weak and strong ties and all of that. But I think that it's very interesting the angle that you also are expressing, you know, in terms of the cultural contents involved in the narratives, you know, that may sustain or not a certain sense of cohesion. And I was thinking about what you were saying, and in Chile we've had a long period of privatization of institutions, of everyday lives, and also in a way I would say like an investment of resources in very, very small networks, you know, family ties, individual ties at the level of, luckily at the level of the neighborhood. And that was basically the message, you know, the dominant message for a few decades. So people, in a way, went back into investing in the resources, in the networks, in the in the relationships that seemed to be meaningful at that period of time.
And lasting, probably. And more lasting
and all of that. And on the other hand, we've got social theories that are quite normative in a way, I would say, of those of the ways in which in the ways in which they see that way of investing in very kind of local, in very small networks, you know. And I think they are very normative because this is seen as individualization and lack of solidarity and all of that. But on the other hand, it's difficult for these theories to consider that the structural context didn't help much for people to preserve different kinds of networks, you know. And so privatization was at some point forced and then sustained in a way that it was difficult not to act otherwise, you know, and not to raise your children in the same ways and all of that. So I'm thinking about how to re-engage or, I don't know, stimulate or promote narratives in which people can also see something shared about those experiences of individualization, you know?
That's great.
It's not only a matter of
my choice
or you know, it's something structural, historical, and it has cultural content, but it's not something that we have managed to express in a more explicit way, or you know, it's not something that my impression is that it's not something that it's kind of available for us and I was thinking yesterday when you were talking about the role of social scientists in providing also resources for opening these discussions. And I was thinking that that is something that needs to be reassessed in a not normative way, you know, as some certain theories that look very in a very pessimistic way. The extent to which individualization eroded, you know, networks.
So, and from what you were saying yesterday or 2 days ago when we were, you know, visiting the city, that in Santiago the poor have reorganized themselves around their families as unit of survival. That I thought was very, very interesting, because in the American context, you know, one of the main research projects is called Fragile Families, mm-hmm. because the dads are gone and the mothers are raising their kids mm-hmm. by themselves with rotating men in mm-hmm. their household. Mm-hmm. So the child might know five dads over a period of 5 years, you know. Mm-hmm. So the reconstruction of the lower class family in the U.S. has gone in a direction of greater anomia. Mm-hmm. And one of my colleagues wrote a wonderful paper titled Disposable Ties, mm. Matt Desmond, which speaks to this fragility. Mm. And people like Jennifer Silva, who has a wonderful book on, you know that book?
Getting Ahead.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's about how people who have been unemployed think that they have to find within themselves the passion they need to, or they draw on, you know, the scripts that they learn from Alcoholic Anonymous, you know, kind of self-improvement scripts to find their way out of the disaster that they find themselves in. And they're hyper-individualized. Mm. So to think, how would you diffuse messages that will tell them, you know, what happens to you now is not your own doing. It's a structural phenomenon. There's another book I like a lot by Ofer Sharon titled Flawed Selves, Flawed System, where he looks at the long-term unemployed in Israel and the U.S., and he finds that in Israel, they are far more distant toward the fact of being unemployed because they think market failure, you know, I'm the victim this year. Mm. They don't think that their self is faulty, whereas the American unemployed people think their selves are faulty. So why is it that this is possible in Israel, which is a far more collectivist society, of course, than the U.S. So all these studies really point toward the U.S. workers as being really in much worse shape because they're losers, you know, within their system, and there's no way out. It's really quite tragic, I think. Yeah. And there's not a lot of talk about you know, one of the things we try to do in this special issue of Social Science and Medicine is to analyze how people with HIV, AIDS, African Americans, and the obese got destigmatized as a group. So that's a case of looking at social inclusion by looking at processes of destigmatization and the trajectories of these groups. Absolutely. So I think that's, you know, I mean, if we could think together about pathways through which social cohesion is produced and look at all these pathways from networks to cultural repertoire as complementary and working in connection with each other, you know, I think that could be quite interesting.
Absolutely. Yeah, because I was thinking, remember when we were looking at Santiago a few days ago, we also talked about religion and how the evangelics were a group that was growing, especially within the working class areas, and had become something very important in Chilean society over the past decades. And we were just saying that there is a long bank holiday because one of the days is for the Catholics and the other one is for the evangelicals. Mm-hmm. And so I was thinking those terms, you know, because I think that even for sociologists, it's difficult to understand that maybe there are some scripts, narratives, repertoires that are being available for people, you know, and from from that religious point of view, which is different from the Catholic, and most people probably were Catholic before and then changed because obviously something meaningful was being provided.
And I know in the American context, there are books on, it's called Prosperity Evangelicalism. One of my colleagues at Harvard, Marla Frederick, wrote a wonderful book on these mega church, which are extremely popular among immigrants, Brazilian immigrants, Latino immigrants in the U.S., precisely because it gives them scripts about how to be upwardly mobile, which is based on, you know, be focused on your long-term goals, don't decry racism every day, and instead, you know, move forward. And it's a kind of positive form of positive thinking that some people would think is very alienated, but nevertheless, they find a lot of emotional supports in those systems. And
this is a different kind of question, but I really wanted to know a little bit more about your role as president of the American Sociological Association during this period, this year and next year. And I wonder if you could tell us a bit more about which are your priorities, which mm-hmm. are the topics that you would like mm-hmm. to promote, or you know, yes. to give visibility to?
It's the main priority for me. There are a standardized exam at the high school level mm-hmm. in the US called AP Advanced Placement Exam, which high school students can take and get credit in college. Mm-hmm. And the most competitive colleges consider how many of these AP courses students have taken mm-hmm. before admitting them. It's like one of many things that are on the resume of students that make them more or less competitive. Mm-hmm. All the other social sciences, but anthropology and sociology have it. Mm-hmm. So my main goal is to get AP accreditation for sociology. That's because great. I feel this is important in terms of exposing high school students to what sociology is, mm-hmm. which will then have, you know, other positive effect on people taking sociology when they are in college. So the college board, which administers all the standardized exam, like the, you know, the SAT, is the board that is approving that. So we're in the process of constituting a kind of blue ribbon committee that will help me make the case. So it's a I'm very excited about doing this because I think it might really make a difference for the discipline, for the health of our discipline, mm-hmm. which is not in bad health. There's a lot of jobs for, unfortunately, sociology always prospers when there are, you know, racism, poverty, immigration crisis. So there are lots of criminality. Mm-hmm. So there are lots of jobs now in medical sociology, in, you know, crime and deviance. So we're not in a bad shape compared to some of the other social sciences, and we're also much more multi-methods than political mm-hmm. science, and, you know, I think all things considered, things are not that bad. But the discipline is also always a discipline where people who don't teach in research universities feel that they are not properly represented, mm-hmm. and there's a sense among faculty of color that they're not sufficiently represented. Mm-hmm. These claims also happen in other disciplines, like the American Political Science Association, but they are barely integrating mm-hmm. women, so they're like 10 years behind us. But one of the things that came out at the last annual meeting this summer in Seattle is there was a town hall meeting where 400 faculty of colors got together, and it was largely a moment where people expressed their alienation about their place in higher education, mm-hmm. in their department, where they're often the only faculty of color, mm-hmm. but also in the profession and in the association. Mm-hmm. So in response to this, we are organizing various things like a Twitter campaign with the hashtag #InclusiveASA, with the goal, it's very much, I think, connected to the Getting Respect book, because mm-hmm. it's a question of acknowledging this is the reality that people experience mm-hmm. and create condition for greater intersubjective solidarity, yeah. for people to say, yes, this happened, yes, mm-hmm. this is my reality as well. Mm-hmm. And this is emerging also. There's another hashtag that went viral a couple of days ago. It was hashtag these academic hands, as in throwing your hands up. Mm. And it's, again, a bunch of academic people of color expressing their alienation and their frustration. So it's a little bit like the Black Lives Matter movement is spilling into the life of the American Sociological Association. The person who will follow me as president is someone named Eduardo Bonilla Silva, who is from Puerto Rico, and he's written a lot on racism. So we're going to be addressing this in various mm-hmm. ways with another town hall meeting next year. But at the same time, because I teach at Harvard, I'm very aware that a lot of white men in elite institutions mm-hmm. are very concerned that the organization has gone through politically correct. And they feel that they are the ones who should be in charge because they think they're the best researchers. So it's a little bit of a complicated animal because you have, you know, these people who feel like, you know, they should be the legitimate heir. Mm-hmm. People of color feel they are underrepresented. Mm-hmm. Soon we're going to be publishing tables that show they're not that underrepresented. Mm-hmm. The ASA has gone a long way in terms of becoming more diverse. And then you have white women who mm-hmm. have been elected 4 times in a row. And some of these other people think, well, these white women, they get everything. So there's a kind of backlash against a white woman, you know. Really? So it's a complicated, I mean, sociologists are very concerned about these questions. These mm-hmm. are the questions we study. So it's not surprising that it's part of the kinds of things that you have to deal with as president of the ASA. And it's kind of interesting, I think, from a perspective of trying to grant cultural membership to a wider range of people. And then there's also the fact that it happens that I'm president the year that the person who had been executive officer of the organization for 15 years just retired. So I'm dealing with a new person, Nancy Kidd, who is just absolutely wonderful. And it's a very interesting process to, you know, help her figure out what are the challenges for the organization. And, you know, there's all kinds of things from, you know, people concerned that there's a lot of sexual harassment at the meetings. How do you prevent it? Do we, you know, explain to people how to do bystander intervention? I mean, there's a lot of knowledge about how to do bystander intervention in the case of racism. So, for instance, you don't address the offender, you address the victim, and you talk to the victim. So that the offender can see that the victim has support, you know. So there's a lot of practical knowledge that could be publicized that, you know, I think is, so it's kind of interesting. There's just a lot happening, and it's a good moment, I think. Although the membership of the ASA, like the membership of most other professional association, is declining, and there's a huge crisis with people who are adjuncts. So it's expensive to join the ASA, and many people cannot afford to come to the meetings. So we are thinking about how to create a fund that would allow people who don't make as much money to attend. So there's a lot of issues about access and equity also that need to be addressed. So.
Very interesting. And the next meeting is going to be in Toronto.
In Montreal. Yes. And the topic is culture, inequality, and social inclusion across the globe. And the across the globe is very important to me because as Canadian, I'm very attuned to how many American sociologists are, you know, they don't think that there are other countries in the world. And it's a little bit like fish in water. They live in one world and they're not aware that there are other worlds that are possible. So my hope is that many people from other parts of the world will come and will engage American sociologists to get them to, you know. I mean, I don't want to caricature. Many American sociologists are very cosmopolitan. But there are some fields of study where people are partially U.S.-centered. So I think American sociology has a lot to gain from learning from other countries and other sociologies as well. So,
well, hopefully we'll be there.
I hope so, and I hope many of your colleagues will be there. So,
okay, well, thank you so much for this interview, Michelle.
It's my pleasure. Thanks to you.
Very interesting.
Yes,
thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for visiting us.
Thank you for inviting me.
Yeah.